Okay, so I think we're back in a copacetic situation. Okay, so with immigration, the main difference in immigration and deaths is that with immigration, the people who are going to come in aren't already in the population, so we can't devolve the responsibility for their immigration to person class, because they're not there. They're not in the population. They're absent. So we can't say, oh, take responsibility for your own immigration. They're not there. We can't tell anyone. Who do you tell? So instead, we have this event going off, which triggered immigration. It showed us the basic mechanisms we'll be using for birth, but we had to have it in Maine. Now, for people in the population whose health transitions and diabetes and weight status and any other comorbidities we put in place is captured within the person, that's to whom we look for mortality. Okay? Are we ready for that? Are we ready to add mortality to the model? Okay. Ladies and gentlemen, I'd like you to go to person, and I would like you to add mortality transitions to person. Now, there's any number of different places we could add mortality transitions in this model. One place is we could do so in the diabetes state chart. Another place we could do so would be in the weight state chart. Another thing that we could do would be to add an event which goes off with a certain rate that it's a mortality event, okay? And so the rate changes over time associated with the with their age, and when it fires, they die. So we have a couple different choices here. If you folks, unless you folks have a really strong preference for one of them, I would prefer to show you the one based on a state chart, because it's the most common pattern we see. And you already are familiar with state chart mechanisms. Yes?
I have to deal with, as a nice family, have to deal with background mortality and then
cause-specific mortality. Yep, we can capture exactly that phenomenon here. So I love the suggestion, and I would suggest that we do it in a way that gives a nod to exactly that. So I love it. Thank you very much. And let's put that mechanism into place, okay? Okay, so ladies and gentlemen, I would like you to go now to the state chart palette. And you'll notice that there's a state which is called final state. And I would like you to drag it into your state chart. And we're going to call this final state death. Okay? Okay. Now, we are going to have transitions here. We're going to do it from the diabetes one because this has the largest impact on risk of mortality directly. Largest direct impact, okay? We're going to have a transition from normal glycemic called normoglycemic death, or it could be called dying normal glycemic. Either of those would be, maybe I'll call it dying normal glycemic. That's slightly, because it's the act of dying that is captured by the transition. Okay? Dying normal glycemic, and I will show the name and I will position it appropriately. The next thing I'm going to put in is, here we go. Okay. And hey, oh man, I tried to copy that, but I'm gonna just spare myself the trouble. I'll just drag in another transition, and I'll drag this also to go to there. Okay, and this will be called dying diabetic. Okay, now What sort of transitions will these be? Well, you know, in some models that are very stylized, you might have a timeout of exactly some lifetime associated with the person. But in general, there'll often be a rate transition. We have a certain hazard rate on a per year basis, okay, of transitioning. Okay, now, this is good. This is good. Now, we could specify a fixed hazard rate, but that lacks plausibility over the life course. People are, as we know, they exhibit much, much higher annualized risks of dying when they're older, right? And part of that is chronic disease, and part of it is the depredations of aging independent of that cause-specific mortality. So what I would like to propose is that we do something here that mimics what we did over here, where we took into account age-specific hazards. Remember that yesterday? Do you remember putting that into place? I think some people may remember it vividly. Some people may remember it fondly. Some people may have blotted it out from their memory. So ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to ask you to put in one more for the Gipper. Okay? I'd like you we're going to put in place an age-specific mortality rate. And that has its strengths, that has its many virtues to recommend it, but it does have its downsides as well, and we will reacquaint ourselves with them. Okay, so, ladies and gentlemen, for the rate, instead of assuming a fixed rate, we're going to assume an age-specific rate. Now, you're going to remind me, how did I yesterday have an age-specific hazard? How did I specify an age-specific hazard? What construct did I use for that? And I'll give you a hint. It looks out upon you now. It's a table function. It's right there. Remember that gaining overweight hazard by age? Remember that? Well, you know, we could go up and we could do exactly the same thing again. Maybe what we'll do just to make it easy is copy and paste. And I think, Joanne, the food's coming at 12:30, right? Yeah, great. Great. That would be my preference. Okay. Gaining overweight hazard by age. We're going to call it. So I copied and pasted it. How did I do that? I used, on a PC, I used Control C. On a Mac, I think it'll be Command C, is it? What is it on a Mac? To copy? Control? Okay. Alternatively, you could right-click on this and do copy and then do paste. Okay? Okay, ladies and gentlemen, we are going to now put this into place, okay? We're putting into place another hazard rate that's going to allow someone to die at not at a rate that will be varying by age. So instead of being called gaining overweight hazard, it will be called mortality hazard by age. Notice when I copy, it puts a 1 at the end to create a distinct variable name. I'm going to remove the 1. That 1 at the end of it caused a measure of grief for at least one person in the room in the last exercise. And the 1 is sometimes not fully visible, and it because just the vagaries of how it's laid out, and it's easy to miss. So remove the 1 at the end of that. Mortality hazard by age. And now let's put in a mortality hazard by age, shall we not? What do you think? I don't have pre-specified plans here. Maybe in the first few years of life, between 0 and 5 years, 5 years old, perhaps this tends to be a little bit higher. And you know, people, if anyone here would like to put in numbers and would like to specify those, I'd be happy to accord. I don't know, point in Australia, you know, very, very small rates. I'd be surprised if it's actually that high. 5 to 10 years old, or on 5 years old, I'm going to put it down to 0.01. And we will continue that trend. And actually, I don't think we even need all these data points here. I'm going to eliminate some of these data points by using this. Okay, maybe I eliminated one too many. Probably should have retained 30, for example. That's right. Yes, ranges of teenage years exhibit elevated risks, particularly in a gendered fashion. So maybe between, you know, 5 and maybe around 15 or 18, there's some particularly high risks. And then by 20, it's down again to, or by 25, it's down again to smaller values. And then maybe it, you know, rises somewhat to 40. We're starting to get at the range where depredations of some chronic diseases start to become evident, and then 50 perhaps. These values are way too high, probably, but maybe 0.01, and then 60, maybe 0.02, and then 70. These are, again, annualized hazards, 70, 0.05, and up to 90 with 0.1, something like that. Forgive the crudeness of that, but I'm just putting in some numbers there. I think you'll recognize that there'd be no shortage of empirical sources. In fact, some of the models I've given to you have empirical data drawn from, you know, from population-wide registries, what have you. Okay, so here we have this progression that shows somewhat higher risks in the youngest years in life, in teenage years, and then a general ambient rise with age associated with mortality. You know, the focus here is conceptual. It's not these particular numbers, but these will serve us fine. Are we okay with that? Okay. Now let's capture now this in a fashion that is affected by cause-specific mortality too, right? So maybe we have in place here we'll put associated with each of these transitions here a call to that new thing, mortality hazard by year. So I'm going to put in right here, mortality hazard by year, by age, excuse me. And then what do I put where it says X? What does it need to do its job? If you read its name, what does it need to do its job? It needs what to do its job? It'll give you back mortality hazard, but only if you give it an age. Thank you. Yeah, an age. Good. So how do we get someone's age? We did it yesterday. Anyone remember? Current age. We call current age. Current age. We ask my age. Give me my age. Hey, man. Current age. Give me my age. Having gotten your age, you pass it as an argument. In other words, you pass it to mortality hazard by age, and it will give you back mortality hazard for yourself. Does that sound okay? Does that sound okay? Okay. That the utterances could be more unambiguous. Okay, so that's for the rate here going to dying normal glycemic, and then dying diabetic. We're going to have the same thing. Mortality has by age, but we're going to do something different. We're going to put in place a cause-specific relative risk, or a hazard rate multiplier associated with that. A number that's going to indicate for us the elevated risk multiplicatively associated with diabetes. let's go put in place a mechanism for having a hazard rate multiplier. Now, we could hard code this in. We could simply place it in here. We'll say, you know, there's an elevated, there's a 10% elevation associated with annualized hazard of mortality for diabetics. And you can do this by age. You could do a, you know, a survival analysis and find how age affects this and relate it to the underlying hazard rate curve, the baseline hazard curve for the population as a whole. Here I've increased it by 10%. But that's kind of a, I personally find it a bit awkward to put in, not awkward, I find it non-transparent to put numbers like that in. I don't know where they're from. And they're hidden within the model. So often what we'll do is we'll put in place a constant that will capture that, that will have a nice name associated with it and that could have documentation with it. What do you think? Do you want to do that?
Yeah.
Okay, that's great. That's great. So let's go see how we do that. Fortunately, once again, as is oft the case today and in coming days, we're going to build on existing strengths. The mechanism for doing that, ladies and gentlemen, for putting in place a constant, is nothing less than a variable. Now, ooh, that sounds weird, but it's a special type of variable. So let's go over to this here, to the DaVincian emblem indicating the agent palette. And let us drag in from that repository a variable. And this variable will be called mortality rate. You should give me a better term for it. Mortality rate multiplier for diabetes. I am shocked that I'm not coming up with the correct term for it biostatistically. It's a hazard rate ratio. Okay. Sure. Excess diabetes risk for mortality, you want to say? Does anyone want to exercise? I mean, just tell me what you want to name it, and I'll name it that.
Excess diabetes mortality
risk. Okay? Are we okay with that?
Yeah.
Okay. That's good. Okay. Great. Okay, and now, ladies and gentlemen, with that variable, I would like to go to advanced, and you could pat yourself on the back, and I would like you to select constant. This is not something that's going to be told from us for name. It's going to be something we have as a constant within person. It's not an assumption we want Maine to tell us about or the model to change, which is excess diabetes mortality risk. And it's a multiplicative risk, so maybe we'll make it 20% higher. Okay, 1.2, is that okay? Maybe it should be higher than that? Does anyone want to say 1.5? I mean, it's applied on a per year basis. Remember, it's a hazard rate multiplier, hazard rate ratio. So 1.2 we'll use. Are we okay with that? Okay. Next, let's put it into place. We're just about done with this. We're just about done with mortality. Okay? So in this dying with diabetes, instead of just having the mortality rate hazard by age, we will have excess diabetes mortality risk times that. Let me put that up, ladies and gentlemen, on the big screen. There we go. And that's what I have. So we have this multiplier, this hazard rate ratio that multiplies by that. Do you see that? Yes. Question? Oh, help. Dylan? Okay. Are people feeling okay with that? Okay.
I'll show it so people can see that. This is a general point that
merits note, okay? So, ladies and gentlemen, it bears emphasis, this problem, because I think everyone who engages seriously will, AnyLogic will encounter this problem at one point or another. You'll notice that when I click on a transition that's connected with this, it's got a green end, okay? Watch this, if I may request that. If I put this nearby it, notice that this has a white end here. That's a sign that even though it's close, it's not connected, okay? So to connect it, you would need to drag it and put it on there. And if you have it disconnected like that, it's going to be a rather unhappy camper if you want to run the model. It's not going to know what to, it's not going to run it properly. It won't be connected. In fact, I think it'll throw a fit when you try to run it. Okay, so other questions?
You need current age. There's no X in there. It's just
you're calling current age. Current age doesn't need any information to do its work. It just is like that. Is that okay? Okay, who else needs help? Okay?
I have a question. Yeah. When you say these are competing risks, or are they additional
risks? Right.
That's a very good question. So really what this comes down to is a biostatistical issue about how to characterize the mortality hazard as a function of the various contributions to it. And you could imagine a way which, I mean, this way is multiplicative. We're just raising across the lifespan, we're raising it by 20%. I'm really doing that here out of convenience because it's really easy to represent for the sake quickly to do. But it's also pretty common, right? You'll have hazard rate ratios associated with certain risk factors that enhance your risk of mortality or suicide, whatever, you know, some potentially cause specific mortality or what have you. So it's pretty common, and so I use that. You could imagine a contribution, and in fact, why don't I cover that in the remaining time this morning? I could cover a contribution where there'll be an additive component of the hazard, and you'll have, you know, essentially some intercept plus beta 1 times some covariate plus beta 2 times another, you know, X2 covariate, and where the hazard rate will be composed out of the exponent of that, which is, you know, a very common term that will show up in Cox proportional hazards analysis, in Cox cause-specific hazards analysis, and, you know, a number of survival analysis formulations. I think even the accelerated failure time model may have something kind of similar. In any case, the point is that there's this very common mechanism of using a biostatistical decomposition, which may have been elicited with survival analysis techniques, and then capturing it in this way that is, you know, you add the intercept, beta 1 times x1 plus beta 2 times x2, and then you take the exponent of that, which turns out to be multiplicative because exponents of a plus b is exponent of a times exponent of b. So you get that multiplicative component. You see what I mean? But it's just with this exponent, there's this sort of log transformation that occurs before the before those betas are used in it. But then you can take the exponent of that. It does turn into a multiplicative thing. But probably for many of the people here might not be familiar with that, but I hope that's helpful for those comments. Yeah. Sure. So we do that a lot.
Since I live in, then there's the distinction between biological interaction and statistical interaction.
Correct.
You should be doing this on that. Yeah. On an attitude, right?
Yes.
Or you can put some of the pathologic science.
Yeah.
Biological interaction.
That's right. And to be honest, I don't know anyone working in the dining. So the question was here from Andrew, that there's this distinction between a statistical interaction and a biologic interaction. And sometimes there's understanding of the biologic interactions, which may be very relevant, but there's no statistical interaction associated with it, that no statistical signature directly there, but we know the interaction is going on. And, you know, within these relationships here, like for the hazard rates, we're treating it, we're treating the formulation of that particular hazard by in a sort of bioclassic, biostatistical way, often. But the model as a whole, of course, is a causal model. So often we'll be using, you know, an understanding of the causal influences, which sometimes will tap into the biologic understanding for sort of what's connected with what in the model. It's just for particular hazard rates, we'll often fall back to the biostatistical sort of statistical interaction component. But I don't think that this whole issue has been elucidated as well as it could be in the literature. And I know myself and some modeling colleagues have an interest in this issue of you know, how best to bring that understanding from the biology and from the statistics together in terms of these rates, et cetera. And I think it's a non-trivial issue. I think there's some learning and maturation that needs to go on, meeting of the minds with the statistical world and the mechanistic understanding of dynamic modelers to really do the best job for that. And I don't think that's currently in place, and I'd be interested in fostering. Okay, so ladies and gentlemen, we should have mortality in place now. So if we run the model, what would we see? Oh, wait, sorry. We have one final thing. Truly the coup de grace. The real core of the matter, the real central piece of the matter, which is this death. We have not specified how death takes place. Should we make that happen? So when someone enters this state, when they enter the death state, what will happen? Well, I'm going to teach you something here. I'm going to teach you two things. Okay? Are we ready to see it? Okay. Where are we right now? Where are we performing these things? We're in person. I need to tell the population, hey, knock this person out of the population so they'll disappear. Basically make them disappear as an entity. We actually need to tell the population that. Okay, so watch this. I need to tell the population. Now, where does the population live, ladies and gentlemen? Does it live in each person? No, it lives in Maine. So we have to actually say here, and I will just note before I say this, there's a thing called Maine here that will direct us to Maine. So we want to say Maine.population.remove. Okay? Hey, oh man, okay. Dot population, yeah. And we want to say remove, okay. That's what I'm going to go do. Yeah, exactly. Remove population, yeah. So that's, and I'm saying remove myself from this population. So both add population and remove population, we need to call a special method here that's called accordingly, which is a little bit unfamiliar, but that's how it works in any logic for now. Yeah, Dylan.
So there's also the delete self method. So are you showing them this for a particular reason, or does it matter which one it's?
No, I don't care one way or the other. So I actually have never used delete self.
Oh, basically, so you can just call delete self, and what that does is it removes the person from whatever collection that happens to be part of the collection.
Oh, nice, okay.
And it does some checks saying, you know, are you still, are you still part of the flowchart or something like that? So,
remove agent from...
Sorry, it's just this dot delete self.
This dot delete self.
Yeah, so you don't actually need to know...
Oh, nice, sweet, okay.
That,
okay, that's That's nicer. Thank you. That's great. So that does the job, remove population, but it also cleans up other things.
Yeah, and you don't have to know which population it's a part of. So there might be
exactly.
Population yep. Moving a person.
Exactly, yeah.
And that method will just figure out mm-hmm. what said, where yep. to get rid of it.
So this dot delete cell. That's great. Thanks, Dylan.
Only in the last few versions.
Yeah, I don't remember it from time immemorial.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Are we ready? Okay. So this is in, to be clear, I'm doing this in the final state, which has a Death Star-like appearance. Okay. Okay, this dot delete self. Are we okay with that? Okay, who would like a little bit more time? Are we ready to run it? Okay. Okay, ready? There we go. Okay, so what's going on here now? Immigration is still occurring, but what else is happening? What else is happening? Are people disappearing? They are disappearing. They are disappearing. But I have some facts of life that I need to talk with you about once again. It's time to talk about the birds and the bees once again. And I'm sorry to have to tell this to you, but I feel that I'd be pulling wool over your head if I didn't tell you about this. Okay? The deal is, do you remember? Maybe you blotted this out. Can I draw your attention to an uncomfortable feature of this model? A feature that none of us wish were there, but it's a nod to the reality of things. And the feature, ladies and gentlemen, is nothing other than that. Do you remember that? What was the purpose of that?
It was to adjust the population in that state.
Yeah, it was to adjust something indeed. It was adjusting the hazard rate so that it would be recalculated on a regular basis. Do you remember that? So every year we'd be sure to recalculate the hazard. So for that next year, the appropriate hazard would be in place. Guess what? Can I tell you? We need to do a similar thing where? So that this rate of mortality is recalculated every year. I'm sorry to say it. Otherwise, it will happen to be recalculated when someone's changing weight status. It will be recalculated occasionally. But if we want it to be sure to recalculate every year, we need to put it in place here. So, I hate to tell you that. It's an awkward, ugly fact, and hopefully someday it will be fixed. But it's probably not the first ugly fact you've had to deal with in life, and it's probably not the worst. So I'm going to do something now, which I hope will be quickly dispatched. I'm going to go over here. I'm going to copy this link, which we built with some care yesterday, to bend it round. Do you remember that? We had to bend it to our will in a quite graphic fashion. I'm going to copy that, and I'm going to paste it, and I'm going to go dock that thing over here. And now I'm going to paste it again, and I'm going to dock it over there. And that, ladies and gentlemen, is the grim fact that because this rate is varying by age, we want it to be recalculating it by age, and we need it to dock there. I'm sorry that's the state of the art. I'm sorry that we have not delivered better technologies than that, but that's the current state of things. We're working with methods that will make this much easier, but they're not yet out of the lab and into practice. So that's what we have to live with for the moment. We're recalculating it.
And in the grand scheme of things, I've seen worse. Okay, so I'm going to build this, Dylan.
So if so, one thing we can do, if you're going to have to do that a lot in a model, is if you just make an event that
right calls on change.
Calls on change once every year, then it does the same thing. It's less visually cluttered. It's not pretty either, but it's good to know that the option exists.
Yeah.
Effectively, what that does is whenever you go into a new state, it basically kicks the agent and says, hey, look, something changed. Go recalculate whatever you need to recalculate.
Yeah.
And so you can manually kick it if you want.
Yeah. Yeah. It's kind of pick your poison. You could do the event thing and call on change. It's, yeah. Okay. So build your model. And now let's run it once more. And we should be seeing mortality really, you know, taking place over time. People are subject. Now, initially the population, it has diverse ages, and you should start to see some people leaving. You'll notice the population is out of balance. There's actually quite a few more people coming in than seem to be dying due to mortality. There are people who are occasionally disappearing, it seems, but we have an overall growth of the population. How do you think the population will be changing over time? Well, those who are used to a system dynamics perspective will recognize that the same basic perspective on stocks and flows that's so useful there can be profoundly useful in understanding this situation. We could actually map out how many people are in the population very easily. Tell me, in terms of building strengths, how would I add a chart that shows the number of people in the population? Can anyone tell me? Where would I put it? In person or Maine? Maine, let's go up to Maine. Let's go down Maine. Okay? And now, let's suppose we want to put the chart up here. What sort of plot would it be to plot out the population size over time? And where would I get, from whence would I get it? From analysis, good. What sort of plot? Time plot, indeed. Okay, great. So it's a time plot here. And we are going to plot what? This will be plot population size, right? Great. Yeah. Alternatively, you know what, ladies and gentlemen, we could put it on this other plot which we have in place. This is the diabetes case count. Why not put it on the same plot? What do you think? Is that okay? So let's eliminate that new one. Let's go down and put it here. So here we'll put it on this other plot we already have. How would I do that? Looking at this, how would I do that?
How would I get it to be added here? Anyone? Yeah, you use the plus. That will add a new data item to be plotted. Okay? And then let's call this population size. Size. And what's its value going to be? Okay, first of all, who would we ask? To find out the population size, who might we ask? Who do you think would be responsible for keeping track of that information in the model? It's in Maine, but population. So we could say population dot, and what do you think we need to ask it? Well, look, many times you might not know what to ask. Some of these things you can look up on that little, you know, piece of information I provided on common functions. But let's do control space here. Notice we haven't put anything there yet, and we'll see everything we can ask. We can ask a count of something. We can ask the average. Oh, there's something called size. What do you think about that? It says size returns the number of elements in this agent population. What do you think? That's what we want, ladies and gentlemen. It is that we put in place. Okay, should we run it? What do you think? Okay, let's go.
how do you think the population will change over time here? Suppose we were to look up. How do you think it will change over time? Is it going up or down initially? It's indeed going up. In fact, it's rising steeply at first. You can see it here. Here's the prevalent case count of diabetes, but this is the population size up here. Okay, it's rising. It's rising ever more strongly. And actually, what's taking a lot of time is connecting people on networks, which, you know, is unfortunate because we haven't really been pushing on that issue yet. Okay. It's still rising steeply, but it's rising less steeply than at first. Why is that? Anyone want to hazard a guess? Why do you think it's rising less steeply over time? People are starting to die. There's mortality. From a stock and flow perspective, there's an inflow, number of people coming in, which is some fixed rate. Right? We said, I think, what was it, 5 per month? And then we have people leaving, which is proportional to this, well, that is according to this age hazard, age-specific hazard. And if we ran this far enough, we would find that it plateaus out nicely. Now, there's a lot of work going on right now just to get people connected in networks, which is really not necessary yet. So I'm actually going to, when I go to this immigration event, I'm just going to avoid applying the network, and it should go quite a lot faster now, okay? So I'm just going to run it, and it'll teach a lesson about how these things tend to behave. Okay, here we go. And you can see it's running a lot faster now. And you see what happens. It reaches a sort of equilibrium in population. At this equilibrium, what do you think is the case? Why is that in equilibrium? Why is it more or less in equilibrium? Why is it staying there? Because the number of births, or number of immigrants per unit of time equals the number of deaths per unit of time. So let's suppose we consider ourselves over a year. Roughly speaking, the number of immigrants who come in equals the number of deaths of people who leave, and therefore it stays in this kind of equilibrium. But it's stochastic. It varies by the vagaries of people's age structure, how long they've been in the population, their diabetes status, etc. And you notice the diabetes prevalent case count is sort of similarly fairly stable. Dylan. Very good. Yeah, I didn't require everyone to do it, but I went to the immigration event and I simply did, and I should have explained this, I commented this line out. In other words, I indicated this line is to be ignored. I left it there, but I put // in front of it, which means basically leave this in place, but or, you know, don't pay attention to this. That's what it means. Don't pay attention to this. This comment. That's what the // means. Okay? The hole next to this line, don't pay attention to it. And if we do that, it will go much faster because it doesn't have to worry about every new immigrant figuring out to whom they're connected. Okay, ladies and gentlemen, are we ready for the final component with births? Are you ready for that? Okay. So, there's two ways we can accomplish this. Okay? So, I closed AnyLogic. Okay, that was unfortunate. So could anyone give me one way that you might capture births? Suppose you want to capture the population. How might you capture them? Anyone? Okay, you could have an event firing at the main level. How is it different from immigration? Well, it depends how many people are to give birth, right? And we might need to keep track of that information in order to have the right rate. In other words, if there's only 100 people in the population, right now the immigration rate is fixed. Remember we set it at 6 per month?
But births, we surely, it has to depend on people in the population. Give me another way it could be captured. So you could do that at the main level. You'd have to just keep track how many people are there in the population, how many women, maybe women of childbearing age. What's another way? What's another way we could do births? Anyone? Another way births could be added. Is that right? What? Okay, you could put in place a state chart where you're non-pregnant, pregnancy state, after 9 months of pregnancy, a baby's delivered. You could do that. That'd be an easy thing, fairly easy to do. How about another way? You could put in place an event which occurs at the level of a person. It occurs with a rate that's age specific, right? So that person is within certain age groups, a certain birth rate for those age groups. If you have male and female distinguished, then maybe you have a fertility rate that's applied at certain ages. I prefer one of the latter two methods. How many people would like to see the state chart way of doing it, the pregnancy state chart? Okay, you're tired of state charts. How many people would like to see the event way? Okay, great. People are less tired of events. Okay, great. Event it shall be.
Okay, ladies and gentlemen, I would like you now to go to person. Believe me, lunch will be coming. We'll be eating it on time. Yes, Dylan.
If you really want to get fancy, you can make a discrete event pipeline for the pregnancy of a person.
You could. AnyLogic has many ways of skinning that cat. But yeah.
If you were doing a model of diabetes.
Yeah. Right. Right. Sure.
I haven't actually asked a question, but I'm assuming.
Yeah. So it's a good question. It depends on the research frame that your question encompasses. I mean, a lot of the work we do looks at diabetes risks associated with diabetic pregnancies. And so they are representing the diabetic pregnancies representing all pregnancies and the risk factors associated with them, associated with weight and age and parity, et cetera, are really central. If you're dealing with a sort of population dynamics for diabetes in general and diabetic pregnancies are not of particular interest for your research question, then I would say putting in place an event where you don't have to represent pregnancy, et cetera, is perfectly fine. So I think it depends quite a lot on your research frame, okay? Okay, ladies and gentlemen, so here, and it's a very good point, remember, models like maps are specific to purpose. What we put in or what we leave out depends on our purpose. I think in this case, we can put in an event and we'll do just fine. So let's go down, go to person, and let's put in an event, and we will say birth. Say birth. Birth event. Okay? Birth event. Okay, great. Okay? What sort of event is it? Is this occurring once or what sort of trigger type? Is it with a timeout or a rate? It's a rate, a certain rate per year, okay. Because the person gives birth? We could put it in Maine, but if it's in Maine, we need a way of having it go off more frequently if there's a larger population, because births, contrast to how we represent the immigration, to be face plausible, births which should not be appearing at a rate that's independent population size. If there's no one in the population, there should be no births occurring in the population. If there's many people in the population, there should be many births occurring. The rate of births per year is high. And so because we need that coupling, because
because it's fundamentally dependent on how many people there are to give birth, a natural place to put it is in person. Could you do it in Maine? Yes, you could. It would just be a little bit, it's kind of like where the cow, you know, that's that old system dynamics question. You know, where are the things where are the things that are responsible for the action? You could put an event in Maine, but you'd be sort of separating it out from the key people that are responsible for making births possible, which means you have to do a lot of fix-up work in terms of how many people are in there in the population, and therefore how quickly we should be getting on. It's much more natural to put it here in the population. The reference there is to, and there's a wonderful article on this, but it's a topic that goes way back to, I think, work with Barry Richmond. I remember an article by him from 30 years ago in the system dynamics literature saying, look, if you want to model milk production across the U.S., you know, the amount of milk that's produced, you got to have cows in the model. You don't want to just do a statistical analysis that says over time you see this amount of milk being produced by year. You understand the mechanisms by which milk is produced in order to reliably anticipate, particularly how interventions will affect things. You need to take into account the mechanics of the system. And this was, you know, in a context long before dynamic modeling was, you know, so well accepted as it is today, and when people still felt, you know, statistical approaches, which might do a regression analysis, temporal regression analysis, and just call that done, where those were, you know, the motive of what was perceived as rigorous modeling. And he pointed out, and it's rightly so, that, look, if you leave the cows out, you're going to be answering a lot of questions in a nonsensical way, because you're not dealing with the real mechanisms of production. And so it is here, that if we're kind of putting it in Maine, we've either got to do a lot of fix-up work to account for the fact that it's a different number of people who can give birth, or we'll be putting something, that's positing something that's plausibly, that's clearly impossible. Like, there's a fixed number of births no matter how many people there are in the population. So it's just a little bit more natural to put it in person because it's the persons that are responsible for giving birth.
Instead of applying fertility rate to the population,
you're
applying a probability of...
Well, fertility rate to each person. Right, and the reason for this, great question. So you could apply a fertility rate across the whole population, but most fertility rates I work with are age specific. And so that would require us to go through the model population, figure out how many people there are of different age groups and so on, and try to apply it accordingly. And there's a lot of work to that. It's much more natural to just have each, if you have women in the model, for example, to have each woman, you know, take a look at her age, apply the appropriate mortality rate, get that hazard, and determine whether she's giving birth in this given year. And that makes it just, it makes it cleaner and clearer than if you tried to put it all up in Maine and sort of enumerate all the women of different ages in the population and apply it. It's just much more natural. Each woman is responsible for determining if she give birth in that year or not. And that's much more, it's also much more flexible strategy, because fertility might be a part of it, her age is another clear thing, but it may be that there's, you know, she's of certain medical condition or what have you, she's not capable of giving birth, and that could all be taken in account of the woman. So rather than kind of going through each person in the population as an all-powerful, all-seeing main, and sort of saying, is this one, you just have each person do it for their own sake. They determine if they give birth. Does that make sense?
Yeah. And this is kind of part of the philosophy of agent-based modeling, that, look, birth is an action of a person.
It's an action, and therefore the responsibility for representing that action lies in the person. It's part of kind of how we think about the world from an agent-based perspective. Mm-hmm. And just like the system dynamics perspective, it's consistent as its own sort of logic to it, and its own, you know, traditional ways of doing things, but a lot of those are based on trying to avoid being burnt, or because it's efficient from another perspective. Is that helpful?
Yeah.
Okay, very good. Other questions? Okay, so we're going to put in place the birth to die. Yes, question, sir.
It's kind of the corollary. I just want to confirm with your mortality. This is actually looking at individuals. So when you, in the background there of the model, is there some kind of Monte Carlo replication
or Monte Carlo simulation, so that, you know, you've got a rate, say, at 0.05, but I'm an individual. Right. So is it doing it at the individual level and working out when you die or not?
Correct.
Is it binary?
Yeah.
Is
that what it's doing?
Well, yeah, it's figuring out, it's more than that. It's not like it's a Bernoulli process where, you know, you have a flip of the coin and some fixed time steps. It's actually figuring out here, based on this hazard rate, it's actually figuring out a time associated with which you'll die. But then as the hazard rate changes, it's updating that estimate. And effectively what it's doing is, for given intervals of time, say a given year, it's figuring out, you know, based on the hazard rate that's occurring for that year, you know, do you die during that year? And then it's being updated. That rate is being updated each year as you age.
And it's making the decision whether you die or not, because basically you're going to probability.
That's correct. So when we have a, and forgive me, but this is a technical discussion. So it's very good. So when we have a hazard rate, here, this hazard rate is changing, but at a given time, for a given time interval, it would be constant, right?
Sure.
For a given year, let's say, it's constant, right? And we have here this hazard rate that's constant applying for that year, and that is associated with certain distributional assumptions. The most important one is it's a memoryless process associated with an exponential distribution for your residence time in that state. In other words, your time spent in this state before mortality and normal glycemic is exponentially distributed. So if I have a certain hazard rate, I'm in a state, let's suppose I'm normal glycemic, and I have a certain hazard rate of dying per year, there's an exponentially distributed residence time of how long I spend in that state based on that hazard. Specifically, it would be e to the minus alpha t is associated with the, where alpha is the hazard rate associated, is the probability that I remain in the state after time t, okay? And what it does is it actually draws from that distribution to determine, from that exponential distribution, determine how long I spend in the state. Now, if that draw happens to lie, that draw for how long I'll stay in that state before leaving, happens to lie within that year, if that's the only out transition, if it happens to lie within that year, then I will be dying within that year at that time, fall into it. If, on the other hand, that time lies beyond that year, it will get to the end of the year and it will recompute my hazard rate, then, and figure out again, okay, now it's higher, right? Okay, does my time to die then go beyond that next year? Now, I'm simplifying things in a number of ways. One of the ways is there's a competing risk here, a competing risk to developing diabetes that's occurring with a certain hazard rate. And that hazard rate is, in fact, not shown right now as age-dependent. We could readily do so. It would be a cakewalk now that we have this ugliness in place, but it would be very easy to do so. But there's a competing risk here, and that changes somewhat the situation from the simplistic case that I talked about, because this rate here, you could develop diabetes before you die here, in which case you will transition here, and then the rate associated, the hazard rate associated with diabetes for this transition to death will then apply. And you'll be drawing that to determine when do I die. And so, essentially, there are these multiple, when we have multiple transitions here, we do so in a way that whichever one fires first will be the one with greater precedence.
If the one to death fires before the one to diabetes, the person will die before they develop diabetes. I mean, it kind of stands to reason, you know. If my time till I get diabetes is up before I die, then I'll develop diabetes before I die. If my time to die is up before I get diabetes, I'll die as a non-diabetic. And so it's kind of a commonsensical scheduling there. But what goes on at a mechanical level is drawing from exponential distributions when you have a rate transition in place. Is that helpful? And that's actually what's happening. It actually draws, so this random number generator within AnyLogic, it's the Java random number generator, and it's well sort of understood, studied, and probably runs in hundreds of thousands of programs worldwide. And it is literally drawn from an exponential distribution to determine when to transition. Okay? Is that helpful? Okay. Great. So should we complete this so we can eat? Okay. Okay. So birth event. Right. This will be a rate. And what I really like to do is to have this rate be age dependent. But it's 12:23. The food is on its way, probably. And I would like to, we could put in, how would we do that? Let's suppose we wanted this rate to be age dependent. What would we need to do? You put in your fertility rate into a table function. We've been there before, done that. Do we need to do that before lunch? Yeah. I mean, you folks are hardcore. Okay. Let me get out my nuts here. Great. Okay. Okay. Power to you. I admire ambition. Okay. Let's do this. Let us proceed forthwith. Okay, so I'd like, well, not a custom distribution. Let's draw a table function in, and let's have this be age-specific fertility rates. Now, truth of the matter is, I'm bending things a bit, because there's this awkward fact, which has occasionally been noted, that men don't give birth. And fertility rates are specific to women. Have you come across that? Yeah. We have two options. And both these options are seen in spades in the modeling world. And both, unfortunately, are quite rare. Okay? Option one. We can gloss over the difference between male and women. Male and women. That makes male seem like a monolithic, inscrutable object. Between men and women, we could gloss over that, and we could have people bud off, right? No difference. This is a unisex model, and people bud off at a certain rate, we'll call it fertility rate. Or we can actually distinguish people by male and female in the model, and that will require addition of one parameter. Which do you prefer? Distinguish? You want to do it? Okay. Power to you. Great. I will do this. Excellent. Okay. Okay. This can teach some more lessons. Okay. We're still in good shape. We have 5 minutes left. Okay. We'll be fine. Okay. So, ladies and gentlemen, we don't actually have that much work to do. How do I? This will be excellent. What I love here is so much of what we're doing is retreading on what we did yesterday, which is good. It doesn't just expand infinitely. So how would we add a distinction between males and females in this model? We could add a variable, but probably we want to... A variable is a fixed characteristic of a person. How do we do it before? How do we encode someone's sex yesterday, that very first model we built? yeah, we had an option list associated with the different sexes, and then how do we communicate to each person and then and encode the assumption of what they had? We had a, begins with a P, ends with an R, parameter, indeed, indeed. So, ladies and gentlemen, let's add a parameter. Okay. And add a parameter, it'll be called sex with a lowercase or capital? Lowercase. We've been here before, right? maybe that's like Groundhog Day to you.
Where the same horrible thing happens every day. Okay.
Okay, lowercase sex. Now what do we have to do to support different sexes in the model? We want to add an, I heard it earlier, options list. Okay, new options list. We're getting pretty familiar with this. And is this with a capital sex or lowercase? Capital, because it's depicting a set of all possible sexes, right? And we're going to have female and male. Okay, how did I add that option list? How did I add that option list? What I did is I right-clicked on the whole model, or I did file new option list. Are we okay with this? And it's called capital SEX, with a capital, okay? Dylan, prepare for deployment. Okay? Capital SEX, instead of all possible sexes, right? Does that make sense? Just like capital P is the set of all possible people. It's associated with personhood, personness. Are we ready? Ready to go forward? Okay, great. Okay, now, ladies and gentlemen, coming back to the sex, what type is this? What are the possible values of sex? From whence are they drawn? They're capital S-E-X. Man, you folks are good.
Or woman, you folks are good.
You folks are great. Okay? Okay, excellent. Excellent. Capital S-E-X. Great. Okay. We're in good shape. We're in good shape. Age-specific fertility rate. Okay, let's put this in place. Zero to 12 years old, we're going to have in place a zero. Starting at 12, we'll have in place a very, very small fertility rate, 0.001. 12 to 25, we'll have a successively rising fertility rate. This really specifies that at certain points, maybe it will go up to 5% per year by age 25. By age 40, it's perhaps down to 2%? I'm clueless here. Sorry. By age 45, it is down to 0.005, and then about 45, it is down to zero, let's say. It's not true, but okay, fine. Fine, so we have something like looks like that. Okay, that's our age-specific fertility rates. Okay? Are we okay with that? Okay. I admire ambition. Okay? There's our age-specific fertility. Excellent. Excellent, excellent, excellent. Dylan, ponder making the rate of a event dependent on age.
Maybe.
Yeah. Yeah, but you can't have self-transitions within to cause it to recalculate on change.
The question becomes, do state chart changes?
Indeed.
No, that cascade. That should cascade.
Could you double-check that by calling a function from a event and seeing if it's recalculated every year? That would be great. Thank you. It's easily verified. Okay, ladies and gentlemen. For birth event here, we want it then, what will the rate be? Well, for men, what's the rate?
Darn right. Okay, so for the rate, we're going to say if the sex is male, remember this syntax from yesterday? Okay, each time you see it, you'll be scared less. Okay, this is what I'm doing. If sex equals male, it'll be 0.0. Otherwise, what will it be? Age specific fertility rate. Fertility rate, and I'll put this up on the big screen in just a second, based on my current age, right? That's all there is. Do we need a semicolon here? No, we're just determining a number. It's just a formula.
It's just determining some value, some number. That's what we want. Okay? Okay? Is that okay?
Okay. So if they're male, their fertility, well, Jeff would have a more colorful term for it. Their fertility is zero. Otherwise, it is this age-specific fertility rate. Okay? Yes?
Yeah. So when any event occurs in the agent, a message is received. If a message is received, the parameter is changed, event occurs, or the explicit call on change, or a transition occurs.
Yep.
Great. Is what AnyLogic's official document is.
Great. Okay? Ladies and gentlemen, do you understand what I'm doing here? If they're male, they have zero fertility. If they are female, they use the age-specific fertility rate. Are we okay with that? Okay? Okay, ladies and gentlemen, there's only one thing that remains, and what is that? We could run the model, and I think you'll be a happy camper, but there's one happy event which is left out. Now we have to specify the sex for each immigrant who comes in. It's not a big deal. It's just lunches awaiting. Let's just get her done. You ready? Okay. I'm going to say here, that we are going to have, this is for adding in the population, we are going to have sex be equally likely. And I'll show you a different way to do it. Okay? Equally likely. Or do you want it 51%? I'll do 51%. Watch this. So random true, I'll put this up on the big screen in just a second, 0.51 with 51% likelihood they are female. Otherwise, they are male. Okay, here we go. It's going up on the big screen now. Boom, that's what I want. Where did I do this? I did this in this immigration event. It threw a fit because it said, you want me to specify sex? You're not specifying sex. You gotta tell me the sex of this person who's arrived in the population. And this thing here, can I show you? This is new. This is basically saying, with 51% chance, return true, otherwise return false. If it's true, they're female, otherwise they're male. Okay? It's a great question. We could go specify a sex distribution with a custom distribution right now, and that would be an easy enough thing to do. We could do the same thing, and that would be my inclination. Okay? So this is 51% of the immigrants are female versus male. Or should we make it something different? Do you want to make it? Well, that's fine. Okay, 51% are female. Okay, are we ready with that? Okay, are we ready to add the happy event? What happy event remains besides lunch? We have to add the baby to the population. I mean, after all, that's the crux of the issue with the birth event, and we don't have the baby being added. Can I add it for you? Okay. Okay, how do we add the baby to the population? This is the key thing. It's just how we added the immigrants to the population. Remember how we did that? Yeah, we need to do it to Maine, darn right. Remember, this is our immigration, we had to call add population? But we need to ask Maine to do it. We did it here because we're already in Maine. We could just ask it directly. For the birth event, we have to say Maine.addPopulation. Add underbar population. And we need to specify now the birth time. What is the birth time? This is going to be nice. This is going to be what Dylan's generation calls sweet. Okay? Okay, so ladies and gentlemen, what's the birth time here? I'm going to put a semicolon because we're telling it to do something. Add this person. What's the birth time? A baby is born. What's the birth time? A baby is born now. What's the birth time? Now. It's current time. What's the initial diabetes status of the baby? Normal glycemic. And we could, for just being consistent about, we'll say normal, a person dot normal glycemic. Oop, dot normal glycemic. Normal glycemic. It's not person. Normal glycemic. That's their initial state. That's what that wants, initial diabetes state. And what's their sex? Well, this is the thing Joanne was asking about. Maybe with 50% probability we'll make them female, 50% male. That's all there is to it. Let me put this up on the big screen. Boom. There we go.
That's what we have. I know that was painful. But it's not excruciating. I hope.
Oh, well, if you want to have babies, you can set whatever ratio you want. If you think female babies are more likely, we could do this. If you think, you know, male babies are more likely, this could be 0.48 or whatever, but I just said equally likely there. Okay. It's actually another way we could have done that, and there's lots of ways we could have done it. Okay, are people comfortable? Okay, who would like me to explicate something? Okay, so what are we doing here? We are adding this person, ladies and gentlemen, to the population. We're adding the baby to the population. Its birth time is nothing less than the current time. It is initially normal glycemic, because we need to remember, for add population, let me just tell you why I'm doing this. For add population, remember, we need to give it the birth time here. That sounded excruciating. We need to give it birth time, initially diabetes status, and sex. Birth time is time. Initial diabetes status is initially normal glycemic. The sex is determined by flipping a coin. Are we okay? Okay, lots of errors. Okay,
I will attend to that. It's default variable is you could say default variable is name as male, for example. Sex is just all possible values. Okay. Mismatch. Not convert. This should be not sex, it should be sex. That, now it's much happier. And this should be capital F male. And now you're a happy kid. Okay, great. That's a great thing to know. Always spelling and capitalization. Okay, are people, who else needs help?
Okay.
Okay, we've got some genius there. So, yeah. Okay. Okay, so somehow it's expecting initial diagnosis status there as part of that. So let's go and take a look. We're at population. Okay, I'm wondering if you so forgive me here. Main dot. Okay, what should I use instead? Initial diagnosis. Sorry. Add population. Add population. Okay. And we need to do that. Birth time initial. Yeah. For some reason, it wants you to. Okay. So that's fine. Dylan, can you help out here? Okay. So. And you need help as well. Okay. So there's an issue here where it seems for some reason. Oh, I know. There's a missing comma there. That's what it is. You have to put a comma. Okay. Now you can go. Okay. It's a happy camper. Okay. Great. Okay. Okay. That's great. Food will be here in 2 minutes. But fortunately, our births are here now. So, ladies and gentlemen. Ladies and gentlemen, could you run your model? Let's turn off immigration. Let's just stop immigration so we can see births happening. Because otherwise, the immigration will be going on at the same time. Let's temporarily turn off immigration. How do we do that, ladies and gentlemen? How do we turn off immigration? We could do it with that, or we could set the rate to zero temporarily. Okay? Set the rate to zero per month. Temporarily, okay? This is great, okay? And I believe this, is that an indication the food has arrived? Okay, set immigration to zero, and now the rate to zero, now let's run the model. And here we see births occurring. Do you see these births occurring? See that? New babies are being born and added to the population. Oh, okay, a most uncomfortable thing has happened. Okay, console. Okay, there's age-specific, it's looking up age-specific fertility for a woman who's over 90. So, ladies and gentlemen, I forgot when we created the age-specific fertility rate, set out of range to be nearest. For the age-specific fertility rate, out of range should be nearest. And that will mean that if a woman's over 90 years old, it will still be able to compute it. Okay? So, ladies and gentlemen, you should have the population running along, it should have people coming in, people leaving, and babies are coming in, and people are dying due to the age-specific mortality rate. And there's still a number of people connected via networks. And you can see there's a distribution associated with diabetes. Okay, any questions about this before we break for lunch? We doing okay? You got people being added to your model? Okay, great. So, ladies and gentlemen, let's break for lunch now, and maybe we could come back in 45 minutes. Okay?
I just didn't talk.
I will sympathize.
So, yeah, I'm quite happy with the Elstone. We've got a really good crowd in terms of condition.
Nice.
Yeah, people are really starting to come up. They keep on pushing me to do more extensive, which is great. I thought I'm pretty happy with that. This afternoon we're probably going on to the first substantive elements of the health and economic design. That will, I think, be a lot of fun. We've covered a lot of the basics now. And actually had a chance to reverse them and retread them. It's good for them. It's great. I'm really it's a real honor, and hopefully we'll have a lot more understanding here. We're trying to weave together the conceptual side with the crash, go back and forth between the two, catch up to that side of the conceptual side. We should give a lot better understanding of where the model is going to be able to work together with others and plans, et cetera. I'm really looking forward to leading the jury for additional exercise. Quite well. Busy as all heck. Not where we do. It's been a really exciting year in terms of research progress, in terms of funding, and in terms of study launches. So a lot of stuff going on with the with our modeling for larger scale clients, groups of the Ministry of Health, Alberta Ministry of Health is quite interested, but Alberta Health Service. PX is a little bit of interest in what's called modular. Platform they've been using for a while, but they're also standards for a while. And we're doing modeling increasingly with folks all around Canada and around the US on a continued basis. But the other thing that's going on is I this system for epidemiological smart relay system that records sensor data combined with reporting responses to surveys together with crowdsourced information. So that's had some big study launches, and it's getting really big, large scale take up from some of the provinces and some of the parties in the states, the American Legacy Foundation, for example, and so on. So that's had us really busy. Alberta's talking about a rollout of 12,000 to 100,000 people. With a smartphone now, you can collect the data and have a panel that adjudicates what survey should be asked to people following the long-term cohort. So that's some Ministry of Health. That's pretty exciting, and I view that as really valuable for informing the models. They really work hand in hand, because some of the micro-behavior assumptions in the models, particularly about physical activity, sedentary behavior, nutritional intake, mobility, we know how poor people self-report as we do. Our primary data shows it for a number of measures, but also from the literature, people self-reported physical activity and self-reported. So I'm going to be giving a talk on that here, because there's quite a bit of interest that's been expressed by some serious reporters.
One of the things I had when we were doing the
Oh, really?
Wow.
Yeah, well, I think, you know, a lot of what the thing I spend time discussing with Jeff these days, and increasingly some of the SACS folks as well, is, you know, how do we bring together our two ecosystems, you know, over in Canada and here, so that we can best grow capacity here. And you know, I think part of that is people like, I don't know if you remember Dylan, he's now up in SACS, you know, for 3 or 4 months. But then also getting increasingly, you know, institutional arrangements in place that might allow people to come over for exchanges or what have you. Or
I can say, so I'm not able to go on, I'm not going to sort of take that meeting.
Okay. So yeah, I mean, I think some of my students, whether coming out of the undergrad program, gotten substantive understanding modeling from there, or from the graduate program, I'm talking about students who have really immersed themselves in modeling, and our stuff, help modeling. You know, maybe they'd be interested in coming over and really engaging here. And then potentially, you know, some vice versa, going over for training on particular areas of modeling, bringing it together with administrative data, or bringing it together with certain types of physical activity models or GIS. I think that's great, and I'm grateful for your consideration. I think, you know, really the question is, how do we build up a sustainable ecosystem here that you know, so dependent on the vagaries of which my students have to be close to graduation and so on. Further, you know, I think there's a role to be played for other mechanisms, as I said, changing back, or for me traveling over for some building here, and really forgetting some, maybe reaching out to, in a very selective way, to people on the computational side here, engineering side, who might be genuinely interested in immersing themselves in it too. Right, and yeah, I think a lot of it, as I told Jeff, my impression is a lot of it depends on the micro situation in terms of how the departments work and what they reward, and also how the graduate programs are set up. In some universities, what happens is, you know, like our partners at UCLA, what they'd like to do is to hire some folks from the computer science side as research assistants. We have that going on in Michigan as well. The basic deal there is, you know, they pay the stipends for some students from the computational side who actually end up doing theses involved in, you know, the interdisciplinary work. In other cases, you get a real live wire over in faculties there who's willing to, you know, jump into the project whole hog and actually build a research program around it in their own work and have students that are training, sort of like I do. And I think that's also possible, but a lot of that depends on personalities and the reward system and what's considered for tenure and all that sort of stuff. And in UCLA right now, I'm spending some time sort of casing out, okay, who are the potential partners? Because, you know, when I read a computer science resume, I can parse out a lot more things about their interests, because I know that they're really well, and I'm like, okay, that's close enough. Because it has this OR background, what sort of type, see the type of OR he does. I can parse out some things, and the point is that I can help them find partners, like locally, who might serve as training, you know, key training nodes, to sort of help recommend students, alert interested undergrads for these opportunities, right people to your group, or the interface that might be able to then turn to more application side interest. So I think there's some thinking to be done, and I don't think we're going to settle all the issues this trip, but it's good to be able to talk and hear that you're open to this.
Sure. then we can then
I think that's a fun idea. And you know, there will probably be some exchanges post graduation of some of my students over here. We have a training pipeline and pretty good people in mind that might come over, and that's also part of the picture. But that can't be the center of the ecosystem.
But the other thing that's, well, I mean, that's just me and Michael.
Sure.
The other advantage is the faculty and the students can pull through like the research institute.
All right.
And within that, there's a cross-cutting of the faculty capacity and habits. And that's a much bigger problem because it's all the skills and all the certificate research on the ground.
Yes.
And that's where we need to pick up and say, well, we could be concentrated. So this is something we're important to do before we have to do it. So, you know, once we sort of start to think through the possibility of options, I can start to put things in different ways and sort of see what's
going. Exactly. Yeah, I think that sounds attractive. The other thing which we should probably reopen, I know this is something Jack has worked on, I'm quite interested in tracking that. That health institute and people to talk about that. But the other thing is, you know, there are students at undergrad level who might graduate and would be interested in a graduate fellowship or something like that, opportunities. And if they're really immersed in it enough, it could be a manifest asset to your group coming out of that. You know, conceivably that could interest of students, and we could have some come over for graduate study. So you know, I think we've got to think about how all the pieces fit together, and we've got to think about the shorter term sustainability, the shorter term kind of plans, and then the longer term. Oh, thanks. They got mine.
Oh, they got it.
Yeah. No, I really appreciate that. We've stopping by, Rob. It's really good. And really kind of you. But it was good to see a lot of names. I, of course, recognize Gary from, he came over in 2010 or something like that.
Yes, Gary Sachs.
Yeah.
He's one of our key, one of the reasons I'm particularly interested in is in our national health and medical research, which is one of the critical things that Australia has done. They've run a fund competitive grant.
Right.
And within the NHMRC system, we got a Centre for Research Excellence, which is kind of mid-level funding. We got $2.5 million for 5 years to do something. It's sort of like a program as opposed to a specific project.
Right.
And we're working in the context of obesity policy.
Mm-hmm.
And hence, well, this was grabbed my attention. Some of the people here, PhDs, attached to that centre. It's because, you know, it's a wicked problem. It's systems based, and so it just suits.
Absolutely.
But if you're going to apply a proposal in that kind of setting, then you've got to start to get into systems analysis,
and so
I've got that. So that's kind of the most immediate one. I'm hoping to come out of that. A couple of PhD students out here.
Great.
And then I just want to expose my thinking. It's a variety. It's got a big tree. There's a variety of capacities in terms of modelling, but I'm very kind of just enhancing our modelling capacity and just for them to see the human picture's consciousness raising about, well, here's a model of what these things.
Right.
And how to use it.
Yeah. So I appreciate that, and it's good to sort of hear your thinking on that. It dovetails well with my plans for the week, so you know, we'll see as that goes. It's amazing. I didn't realize the scale of things, though. That many health economists.
Yeah, well, in the strategic research centre here, we've got about 70 people across a range of groups. Mm. The most specific ones that are interested, we're going to direct our collaborating to in obesity prevention. Steve Allen, who heads that up, he's got a systems analysis bit, so he's quite interested. So
right.
A couple of his people will all be here or in the city next week.
Mm-hmm.
And so to their big group, and then we've got big and healthy populations to other people.
Right.
And there's a variety of capacity in that. But a number of, that doesn't count for the state. So we're a fair sized group, but my concern really, as you know, when I came as much of yours as I could, it's just that, oh, this is what we're looking for.
Yeah.
We're looking for a way of getting economics into the sort of systems approach
right.
that solves the kind of thing that
yeah. we're trying to do. I think it's a good fit, and you know, I'm going to be trying to weave in here and there, you know, a bunch of things specific to the obesity context and physical.
There's a whole range of stuff. Basically, just saying, I think health economics, we tend to be organized in streams of work because we tend to have people in situ in the organization, so we have strong collaboration.
Mm-hmm.
So we have child internal health and people working with one
of the
major children's hospitals.
I didn't know that.
We have a big stream in mental health.
Mm.
We have a big stream in obesity prevention.
Mm.
We have a big stream in cancer.
Mm.
We have a big sort of stream in cardiovascular disease.
Mm.
We have a lot of health technology assessment.
Mm-hmm.
We're working to kind of our pharmaceutical benefits and larger view.
Mm-hmm.
And then we have bits and pieces around, you know, gambling addiction and the way we've grown really is to get, kind of get key people with strong content knowledge over about just because it's one thing to be one thing
right.
that applies to an area, too much that applies to an area.
Mm-hmm.
You've got to know something about that area
right.
in terms of the urban
totally.
Space.
Totally.
And
totally.
And so that's kind of good. So look, there's a whole range of interests just in terms of that.
That's great to know. I really need to do a little bit of background reading on some of these initiatives and groups that you've mentioned, because for me it's been a whole cacophony of different impressions.
Absolutely.
But what you're saying makes sense of a lot of things that I'm seeing, like the, at least one person for one of the boot camps who reported interest in, for example, mental health, quite a few actual mental health issues.
Yeah,
and then
a couple of you, I think, Kathy New Loftus, who had to leave because she's got about a tangerine. Some of her people here, but look, I can take you through all of that. The general thing is it's a range of applied areas.
Right.
And what we're trying, and some of them will be more amenable to it than others.
Mm.
Some of them, you know, are really central to the systems kind of approach.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And others are less so they can get by with some of the approaches they're currently doing. More standard simulation or Markov model or triage or
exactly. We just had a publication in for on oral health too. Interested in the system science lens in the oral health context, and it turns out it was a lot more textured and interesting than I realized, and actually very short term compared to some of the concerns in other areas, you know, because particularly childhood oral health and its implication can be manifested within the course of less than a decade, you know, in terms of really adverse rates of dental decay. So that's interesting. And some of the guest lectures I'm going to be calling in the next few days, we're going to have people come in via Skype to give guest lectures, and one of them will be on oral health area, for example. We also should think about showcasing some mental health work that Jeff has done as well. That might be of interest. But the obesity side we're going to be covering in quite a bit.
Diabetes.
Exactly. So, in fact, the little example we're doing is kind of around that area. So, that sounds great. So your position actually is not purely specific to the obesity side.
I'm the director of the Strategic Research Center.
Mm.
So within the Strategic Research Center there are six units, and they, you know, there's range for the material of those, but one of those key units is big and healthy units.
Mm.
So I'm also head of, that's my own. I've got Deacon Health Economics, that's got 30 people within that.
Mm.
There's
six or seven basic research streams, of which a VC is one.
Got it, yeah, yeah.
And then there's a whole various grants and things, and I'm on quite a lot of those grants, including being in the Centre for Research Excellence. So I kind of get dipped into all that.
Wow.
In terms of teaching and research and getting up grants and all that stuff.
I didn't recognize that. It was amazing.
Well, I think you're amazing. So, I mean, I'm at that kind of jack-of-all-trades stuff, you know, whereas I, and the problem with that kind of stuff is you kind of be skilled around, I mean, I'm good on some things, I'm good on design a trial, and what the protocol looks like, and what technique you want to do, but you get, if you're not using the software all the time, you just get too skilled.
And tell me, I know, there's some really exciting work going on here in Australia, and I believe Victoria is particularly for some of it that Ross Hammond's involved with on the ABC side. Do you know him at all? Or?
No, Gary
will
know. Gary Sachs and Jay Thru are here.
Okay,
They're both involved with the MIT ABC Commission. I know the name, but it's something that I do a bit of, but I'm mainly in on. So within the Centre for Resource Excellence, there's four basic streams of work, and I'm not even the evaluation one. And what we're doing is economic evaluation on the one hand set to start.
Got
so
it.
So we're doing things like active transport and taxes and follow-up stuff. And so I tend to get involved in that, but there's a couple of other streams.
I'll talk with
Gary.
Gary,
if you know Gary, talk to Gary. He's got a pretty good knowledge.
Great, because I know Ross had come over recently. I think he was also involved with Boyd, but I heard that Boyd is now in New Zealand.
Boyd's in Auckland, yes, at Auckland University, but he's still here. He's still co-director of that WHO Blood Agency for Vinci, and he's 0.2 at Deakin. So, but he's basically moving out. They needed to go back to Auckland to see his wife's mum and he's out there. So, family man's kind of thing.
Right.
But Boyd, not in any one place very often. He's all over the place. He's a world traveller. Mm. He's got some big roles in terms of doing his life, which is all about basically.
I've been so impressed by my past interactions with him in the context of the collaborative BBC modelling network.
He's very good. He's excellent. He was a bit of a loss to us.
Yeah. When did he leave?
Oh, 3 years ago.
Oh, okay.
He's been phasing out after over a period, so that's what I picked. I was his deputy and stuff there, but he picked up and then we got refunded. The strategic research there has a funding envelope of 3 years.
Okay, that's extraordinarily helpful, and I'm sorry to take your time. It's such an honor for you to come down like this and to have come up to St. Man. I didn't realize the scope of things that you were involved in. Incredible.
We're very pleased to have you today. So that's 3 miles or whatever, continuing to chat about different things, because I think that's really quite interesting.
Yeah. Absolutely.
As to how you think we can proceed. I'm hoping that there'll be at least a few people here that are on it.
Right.
Use it.
Right.
And then you say, well, how do I support them?
Right.
And use it. I can't. I'm happy to try and facilitate.
I appreciate it. I'll tell you, it's been such a delight, and I appreciate the support your organization centrally has given to making this possible and so on. I will be back, it looks almost certain, in Adelaide in February. And so the plan is for me to deliver a boot camp there at Flinders. During that time, it is possible that I'll do some travel up to either Sydney, Melbourne, or what have you. And it may be that emails we can do quite a bit, but it could be for some of those more substantive conversations.
Every little time, takes us through that kind of dead time around Christmas.
Right, exactly.
Quite got into teaching, so February is a good time for
that.
All right. And listen, if you ever need a spot you're very welcome to come back at my place. I'm not sure what you're doing, but sometimes you just need a connection between flights.
That's super kind of you, Rob. It's really too kind. We've got me, I will t- take that to heart.
Just say, if it suited you, just drop a nice little like, I kind of need to catch a flight here.
Okay. That's extraordinary. They've got me up right now in this, the Punt Hill Apartments, Richard, just down the street. And it's just amazing. It's wonderful.
Tim works all right?
Oh, it's terrific. They eventually got me in a two-bedroom apartment. Okay. I don't know.
I'm actually looking after you. That's good.
Quite right. Oh, yeah. No, it's been terrific, very convenient, good for my morning runs. And, I love running along the creek.
I'll answer here. Oh. I still haven't done that yet. I've been here 9 years, so I still haven't run along the creek.
Oh, yeah, no, it's a real delight to be along.
Good.
So, just such hospitality. I'm grateful for it. So, we'll see what we can do to leverage this further and to brainstorm further about this ecosystem.
Fantastic.
Yeah.
I might see if I can pop down later times when I'm around the world in various places.
Yeah. No worries. Great to see you. Thank you so much. Take care there. Yeah, please. Great, absolutely. Right. My thought is to come back to it, though.
Well, it's been great to be at the level of the software, but I feel myself as if my mental maps are those two things.
Yeah, come together.
Come together, and you see, and that's actually impeding me in the way that I'm navigating the software.
Yeah.
I'm being a little bit visual about how I think about
the
levels, and coming back to sort of, and that has reinforced to me in the words that it's how we conceptualize where people or where events or where characteristics belong in the software, and how that sort of relates to system dynamics. And also, if you find that would help, I don't necessarily need to come back up to the big pictures. Probably people do get that stuff about system dynamics, which is the mental models that help you make intelligent decisions about complex things.
Right.
But also to know. To have an instinctive sense of where you go navigationally.
Mm.
If you can kind of get that, find it exceptionally modern.
Sure. So you talked about in terms of navigating the software and trying to make sense of kind of how that relates.
Of going home and thinking,
of the problem.
At the moment, we haven't got the individual
and
the population, and we haven't got the household.
Sure.
Children and family.
Right.
It's really, there's the population, there's the area, there's the characteristics of the area, which is a much more multi-leveled model. And I think,
we've got that planning, so that's coming. But let me.
I'm not a transporter, I'm a health person who's dabbling in transport.
Yeah, sure.
Just have a think about that, if you've got something.
Yeah, this is wonderful.
Maybe even just sort of taking a step back and.
Mm-hmm.
Structure
of
it
would
be
really
helpful.
Okay, sure. Let me. No, it's very kind. Let me muse about this. Yeah, I did get a couple things yesterday that made me think, okay, for the moment, I'm going to cut that a little bit short so that I can.
Well, you work short, but is that sort of meso level between macro and the sort of micro level? How am I?
Yeah.
Make sense about
what I'm doing. Sure. I will see if I can. So I need to think about it for just a little bit. But there's first of all, some things are coming that will help on some of those
issues. Everything's lucidating, I'm sort of understanding. And that practice thing is something probably I need to do on my own at home in the data set. The thing that I'm trying to help instinctively gain is I understand how parameters are set. And how they're used. I suppose I thought the model would be peopled by actual data. And I think that's something else that I'm struggling with because of not a model. I sort of thought the actual.
Like data from administrative data set or larger.
And it would be a set of
Models
of how have characteristics. That's also a setting. So what you're actually modeling is much more a unit record rather than some set of
you can do that.
Where you're putting the
I mean, so that's one way of conducting it. It depends a lot on the goals of the model and to what degree you're looking at counterfactual situations where, you know, the situation is going to certainly depart quickly from existing population structure. But a lot of the time we start at least with existing population structure.
I suppose there are some kind of counterfactuals that come into
Yes. That's maybe exactly.
So logically, that's where I'd be thinking that's where you'd start to sort of say.
Right. Okay, you have this population structure. Okay, now we'll put this intervention in place, see how it changes.
What's going to happen because, you know, and what are the big outliers? Is the petrol price coming in? It's going to look.
Yes.
It's all like that. Right. Sort of, that's what excites me.
About
it. But I just don't know, sort of quite.
Yeah.
And I know that you've done a lot of building on this stuff.
So okay. So let me think about how to work this into the prioritization I have for the next few days.
It might not be of other people's things as well. It's just I felt like you were cut short that maybe you were gonna come back sort of down in a way.
I was.
And that was impeded.
Okay, very helpful, and again I'm easy about how to handle this, but I'm grateful. And again, the name is
Ali,
yes. Very pleased to meet you. Thank you, Ali.
I am. Thank you so much.